Okay, I'm Gerd Hoffmann. I'm working for Red Hat and I'm maintaining quite some graphics related stuff in QEMU. That includes both the user interfaces you are using to interact with the virtual machine and also the emulated graphics devices. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. With the focus on OpenGL, because that's about to be integrated into QEMU. It started already, and I hope with the next 2.5 release we will see more of this in upstream QEMU. So I'll start with, I'll start with some news on VGA emulation. With a focus on virtio-gpu, because that is a groundwork to get OpenGL code into QEMU. Then, of course, go into details what's happened with OpenGL and what we are doing there and where we are at the moment and what to expect in the future. And, yeah, that's it. Servers used to be the default VGA for quite some time in QEMU, and it's a pretty old card from the 90s, so there isn't much news to say about it, except that it's not the default device anymore, because it simply can't fit the needs we have today. We make existing hardware, so we are kind of bound to what the hardware in the 90s was able to do, and that just doesn't work today anymore. So, starting with the 2.2 machine type, the default VGA device has been switched from servers to standard VGA, and that's pretty much all the news I have for the servers card. We have a bit more for our standard VGA, which is the new default. We have for the Linux kernel and kernel mode setting driver for quite a while already. It landed in Linux kernel 3.14. Recently, it got registered to switch the endianness of the frame buffer memory. That's important for the PowerPC people, which are using the standard VGA as their default display device as well. And PowerPC just got the little endian port, so it's not, we don't have a fixed endian per architecture anymore on PowerPC, because the guest can be either big endian or little endian. And running the frame buffer in non-native endianness just doesn't work very well, so now the guest is able to switch the endianness using that register. So the QEMU support landed in QEMU 2.2, and the BOSS kernel driver got support for that in 3.19. And in QEMU 2.3, the standard VGA device also got a property to switch the endianness, so the PowerPC code has a way to switch the endianness depending on the guest endianness, so even guests older than 3.19 will get the correct endianness for the frame buffer. We also got support for page flipping, so that you can have two pieces of frame buffers in your video memory and switch between them, which is needed for proper Wayland support, because Wayland basically requires this page flipping, because it's needed for, it's designed to work that way, simply. Standard VGA has configurable video memory. The QEMU support is there already for quite some time. And recently also libvirt got support that you can specify in the libvirt XML the amount of video memory you want to have for your standard VGI card. And if you just specify enough video memory for it, so standard VGI will handle 4K displays just fine. And that's something which Cirrus just isn't able to do because it hasn't enough video memory and because we are bound to the hardware specification from the 90s. You can't change that. But for a standard VGA, it's not a problem. So it's not an accelerated device, but it's a solid baseline device which will serve us well for the next years. Well, that's a shell script you might find useful. This allows to set any random video mode using xrender.
You can, using xrender command, you can add any mode that you want to the X server. The CVT utility is able to calculate a mode line. So this is an easy way to set any video mode because the video mode listed by Xander by default are just taken from the kernel's mode database, and if you want something which isn't in this database, it's not a problem. You can just add any random video mode using this shell script. It works as standard VGA, it works also with QXL, it works also with the virtio-gpu. So that's, if you're just want some mode which isn't listed there, you can just edit this way.
Virtio GPU. The driver landed in QEMU 4.2, which is almost released right now. I think we are on release candidate 7 right now. The QEMU support landed in 2.4. At least the one without 3D acceleration that will follow later. We have two variants of the device. One is a virtio GPU PCI. That one is just a simple virtio proxy device for PCI, which we also have for all other virtio devices, and it doesn't do anything else. And the other one is a virtio VGA device, which does the same as a virtio GPU for proxying to the real virtio device, and additionally has VGA compatibility. So you have a boot screen, you have VGI BIOS support, and the VGA emulation part is actually fully compatible to standard VGA. And so the guest is able to switch. When you boot up your machine, it will be in VGA mode, and as soon as you enable virtio on the device, it will switch to virtio mode. So as I already mentioned, it's to do 2D mode only at the moment in upstream. A nice thing is that it is able to adapt to the window size. So if you're resizing your window or switch it to full screen mode, the kernel will generate a monitor hop-lock device, and the X server, or I think it's GNOME shell actually doing that, will adapt to the new size. So you don't need some special virtualization-specific guest agent, which is different from how Spice handles it. Spice can do it too, but it needs a guest agent running inside the virtual machine, which handles the resize stuff. And virtio GPU also supports a multi-head setup. We can specify multiple heads. It's a device property. Which number of heads you want to enable for the device. by default it's turned off, so you have just one head because it's not tested very much. And we have to still sort some details like tablet support, and but it's there in the design, and it should be easier to use in the future. So on the tablet stuff, that's a bit tricky if you have not just one monitor but two monitors, to and that your mouse events don't need just the position on the screen, but also which screen the input was coming from. And I think the best way to do it to do it in a touch screen manner, because you have the same problem on physical hardware on if you have a multi-head setup with touch screens, because in that case you see just two touchscreen devices, and as a guest, the operating system has to figure out which touchscreen belongs to which screen. I think the easiest to get this going is if you're doing it similar on QEMU. So if you have two heads, you should also create simply two tablet devices. And we have input routing in QEMU for quite a while, so you can say this tablet device should get all input from this user interface window. And on the guest side, we also have support for that. With input, you can set up this and say, okay, this input device, which X server is seeing, should be mapped to that CRTC, and then everything will work just fine, except that you still have to configure all this manually, and that's a big to-do list item to figure out how we can make the Linux guest do all this automatically for you. That once you have set up the input routing in QEMU, everything will work just fine. So, if you want to have multi-head, you also need multiple pointing devices. So you have quite a few choices here. The obvious one is a USB tablet, which is a bit problematic because USB emulation is quite expensive. A lot of this has been solved, at least in case USB tablets are idle, because you can suspend the USB bus then. But as long as you're actively using the tablet, the USB emulation is active and needs to use CPU time. So that works, but isn't ideal. Spice can do this as well, but they need the Spice agent for that. So it works with Spice only. If you want to use something else, it just doesn't work with the Spice agent way. There's also this VMMouse device, which works quite okay in the non-multi-head case, but you can have only one instance, and it's also a bit problematic that it just takes over the PS2 mouse, which in some common cases is a problem because you can't send relative mouse events to the guest anymore once the guest activated the VM mouse, and that you have only one instance basically rules it out for a multi-head setup. And we have a new thing. We have virtio input, and that also supports the tablet device, which you can use, but it requires a pretty recent QEMU and a pretty recent Linux kernel. But as virtio GPU is pretty new too, for the case of having multi-head support with virtio GPU, this should work pretty well. So what we have on the user interface side, which was merged in, is already merged in QEMU 2.4, is rendering the normal guest display, which is represented inside QEMU as a display surface structure using OpenGL. QEMU builder simply copies a guest display to a texture and then render that using OpenGL. It's still disabled by default, but you can enable it with the GL equals on the QEMU command line, and it's actually supported with SDL2 and also with GDK. So that's the very first OpenGL bits, which are actually upstream already. Plan for the near future, we want to allow display devices to use OpenGL. So the display devices need an OpenGL context to do the actual rendering. And because you can init OpenGL only once per application, we need some callbacks to the user interface code, which manages OpenGL to create a context and to delete a context and to make a context active and so on. So we have to add some context management to the user interface code and also some callbacks to actually allow the allow the devices to put the rendered context to the screen. So we have callbacks to say, okay, this is the texture where I rendered my guest output to, and also a callback to say, okay, now I want to have the screen update. And using this infrastructure, virtio-gpu will get 3D support. virtio-gpu has a number of operations to define resources, textures, and so on. And the guest can then send a Mesa Gaussian command stream to the host. And we have a render library created by Dave Elliott to actually render this Gaussian command stream into a texture, and which we then can display using the user interface callbacks edit before. So for all this, patches exist already, so I think the chances are pretty good that we see that in version 2.5. Another one is we need some work to do on GDK, or it's at least very useful to do it, because the most recent release, which is 3.16, got native OpenGL support, which means we have a new widget which is able to render OpenGL. And the drawing toolkit also got some functions for GL context management. And I think that's a preferred way to do OpenGL, and because it requires a pretty recent GDK version, I think we will have those two modes in the user interface code for quite some while. The new one using for versions newer than 3.16, and the older one where we do the EGL setup manually for all the older GDK versions. And with that, QEMU should work fine on Wayland, which is, I haven't actually tested it, but I think it's a problem to run on Wayland without this. Because for X, if you're running on X server, we have to turn off the double buffering, because it just makes our guest display we have rendered using OpenGL disappear if the GK does double buffering. And if you're running on Wayland, you simply can't turn off the double buffering by design. So we really need this native GDK support to render correctly on Wayland, I think. Patches for this exist too. the QEMU, as you can see, the presentation is running inside QEMU, and this is actually using those patches. Another thing we need is headless OpenGL support, because with the SDL user interface and with the GDK interface, your QEMU session is bound to your desktop session. And if your desktop crashes for some reason, your guest is going away. And that's not something you want to have. So we want to be able to do OpenGL rendering even without having user interface running. So Linux got this new stuff, well, not that new, but I think that it's enabled by default is pretty new. It's this render nodes that you can open a special render node and then do rendering on certain rendering commands, do rendering on those render nodes, render something into some texture, and then this texture can be exported as a dma-bufs, which is also not that new, but it's a mechanism for interpreters. Data exchange. So we can put the guest display into a DMA buff and then pass a file handler to that DMA buff to another process, which in turn then can display the user interface. So there is a proof of concept user interface for that. It's just simply named EGL. And there's also simply a viewer app, which you can use to display this. I'm right now using this mostly for testing purposes. It's not yet clear what I do with this long term. Because that's the way we plan to do the SPICE integration in the future is pretty much the same, that we are running into a DMA bus, then pass along a file handler through this DMA buff to the SPICE client, so the SPICE client is able to display the guest display this way. So it's long term, it's kind of duplicate, so I'm not sure yet whether it will merge this upstream or not. So another hot topic is the virtual GPU stuff Intel is doing. They had a demo on that last year. It's called KVMGT, where they separate physical GPU into multiple virtual GPUs where you can assign one of them to a guest. And again, there's the same plan to have the guest display exported by the host driver is DMA buff, and so again we have a DMA buff handler. We can just pass it on to the SPICE client, for example, or we can import it and display it directly, which is the case if you're running on a GDK or SDL user interface, and QEMU needs the texture itself, so it can just import the DMA buff as texture and display it directly. Getting an OpenGL accelerated display to a remote machine. Oh, that's an old slide. Okay. That's a problem which still needs to be solved. The idea is, I think the best would be to have your host GPU also they are able to do video encoding, and I think the easiest and best would be to also encode the guest display simply as video and send it over. It's a bit problematic due to the patent situation. What's missing on the slide is just a few days ago I've learned that there are patches for GStreamer about to land to support hardware assisted video encoding. So I want to have a look at this, because if you're offloading this to the hardware,
we might be able to get around the pattern problems because you don't have to ship an encoder and decoder directly, but use actual GPU hardware. So that's something which we can investigate. And maybe, I'm not sure what where we are in terms of hardware support for free video codecs. That also needs to be investigated, but it seems there's some movement in GStreamer, and if we're able to use that, that would be very nice, I think.
So I hope we have more news on that next year. So if you want to play with this, you need a pretty new Mesa and also a pretty new library for the dma-bufs support. And with older versions, it will still work, but you can't try out the EGL user interface where QEMU is headless rendering. So you are limited to the GDK and SDL user interfaces. You need the virtual renderer library on the host, and you have to build a QEMU using that library from my virtual branch where the not upstream patches are located at the moment. You have to install a special Mesa driver in the guest for the virtio GPU. And you don't need anymore the XOR driver. Last year, this was still on the list, but recently XOR switched over to use OpenGL even for 2D acceleration using the Glamour library. And that's why there's no special XOR driver needed anymore. Normal mode setting driver can also do 2D acceleration using OpenGL. So that simplifies the guest installation a bit. So finally, the resources. The slides are online on this URL. There's a Git repository for the virtual renderer library and the virtual branch for QEMU. And there are also some corporate posts where you can install stuff from. I have some repos where the virtual renderer packages are there, and also Mesa packages are there. Where my Mesa packages have just the guest driver, so you install it in addition to the normal Mesa packages. And Dave Erwitt also has Mesa packages, but they are a complete replacement for the distro Mesa packages, and pretty much the same, but additional have the guest driver in there, so you need that if you want to play this. So, any questions?
So, what are your thoughts or what do you think the direction is for the development of Vulkan? So you guys are using Gallium today, but my understanding is Vulkan's coming and it's going to generalize a lot of OpenGL stuff. Is there a roadmap of convergence? Like, I'm just curious what your thoughts are.
Can't answer that, sorry. Because the virtual render library, which is all the Skyrim command scene work, is written by David Perry. I'm not that deep in the OpenGL
Hello, I'm Zhi. I'm the major developer of Intel GPU, virtual GPU solution. And I have a question. How will you use the DMA buff handle? Will you map it, map it from user space, and then you will copy the textures from the DMA buff object, copy the textures from the object?
I don't think there's a copy involved.
Or you will just use it as, in the GR cores?
Well, Mesa has support to import and export textures from DMA buffs.
Yeah.
I think they try to avoid copying around stuff if possible.
But
that's again something where I don't know the details.
Okay, because you know in our current implementation that you know the buffer object in I95 is a special buffer object, and for now we can support to you know map buffer object from user space. So I'm just wondering if you will use the DMA buffer object like that.
I don't try to map it manually.
Yeah.
I'm just calling the Mesa function, asking Mesa to import this, and how Mesa handles it internally, I don't know.
Oh, okay, that should be fine. Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Do you have any plans about NVIDIA grid virtual GPU?
Well, that's a tricky topic. It's not so much a technical problem, more a legal problem. Because NVIDIA has a lot of binary-only stuff and proprietary software. And I know it works on Xen, but on Xen they sidestepped the GPL problems by simply putting all the GPU emulation into a separate process and then have Xen dispatch the I/O request coming from the guest to either QEMU for to either the NVIDIA emulation for the NVIDIA card or to QEMU for everything else. The NVIDIA emulation, I think the source code for this is open, but it's BSD license, and it links to NVIDIA libraries, which are proprietary. So they can do that with a separate application because it's BSD license, but we can't do this with QEMU because QEMU is GPL. And so at the moment, there's no solution to that deadlock inside. So I think NVIDIA has to figure another way which allows us to use their stuff in a GPL compliant way.
Thank
but
you.
We have no information about the NVIDIA hardware, so it's not something we can do. You need help from NVIDIA on that.
So with respect to the video decoding that you mentioned, so without using hardware on the host, it just means you're passing hardware, you're passing video to the host and have that played back. I mean, why is that better in any way just doing it all within the guest if you are doing it in software on host?
I think encoding a pretty big guest display is a lot of work, and I think if you can offload it to the hardware, we should do that.
Yeah, but you said that like if hardware support is not there, then it probably does make sense, right? For example, if you host hardware that doesn't do H264.
Then we can't do the encoding, or we have to encode it in software maybe. I'm not sure how reasonable that is.
Yeah, so in that case, you probably can do it within the guest just as well, right?
Yeah, but
okay.
I think it's easier to do it on the host. Because
the
workflow
is
the same then, no matter whenever you have a hardware accelerator, then you have the hardware can do that or not.
I guess there's a question on the other hand. So this kind of chimes in with my other question. So I'm guessing, just looking at it from the outside, it's a bunch of very complex commands that you are passing from guest to host. And
yes.
Even with the very simple Cyrus cards, we had a bunch of security vulnerabilities. So have you thought about maybe using something like vhost user to process this in a separate process that we can maybe better contain?
No, not yet.
Thanks.
We have still some time left. So, control. This is our VirtIO the VirtIO VGA device looks like inside the guest. It has three memory bars. The first one is just the VGA frame buffer for the VGA compatibility mode. The second one has the MMIO, all the MMIO stuff. That includes both the MMIO bar, which the standard VGA has, so you can program it even without having access to the legacy VGA registers. But it also has all the VirtIO regions, which are referred here in those capabilities. You can see, okay, this notification area, the true, this offset size, and so on. And region number 4 is MSIX. Oh no, it's not. That's not what I was looking for. Another thing that IO GPU is useful for is for the ARM guests. TCG, and it also has some virtual GPU device, not the VGA variant, but the variant without VGA compatibility. And it has the input devices, virtual input devices we recently got. And this way we have a fully functional console for ARM guests. That's a bit slow, it's TCG. So you can here see it, all with IO based. We have the SCSI, we have the graphics controller, and also keyboard input. So we can work with the graphical console like you can do on x86. So I think that's something the ARM guys are looking forward to, because the VGA emulation has this cache currency problems which the Parley talk is talking about. That's another nice thing which we got from the IO GPU. So I think that's it, what I have. Thank you.